My name is Preben, I'm with the GOTO organization, and with me I have Kenneth Harris II.
Yes, sir.
And I must say, I'm honored.
I'm honored
to share this moment with you. Thanks a lot. And it has been on its way for quite a long time.
Quite some time, over a year.
Over a year. The first time we spoke on the phone.
Yeah.
That was before the pandemic.
Yeah. Over the pandemic, you know, we got that email and it's like, hey, I'm interested in, you know, you coming to speak. And I was like, okay, I don't know this guy, but I have a conversation with him. And we kicked it off and we've been in touch for the past year, and it's been a real experience, and I'm thankful to be here now.
Thanks a lot for joining us.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's like, no matter where I dive into the description of you, it's just, where do I start? It's just filled up with these words that everybody is dreaming about. NASA, satellites, space, this and that. And even on that, there is this Forbes 30 under 30 exclusive list.
Yeah.
What is that?
Yeah, so it's a list that they do each year. They choose 30 individuals in different categories. My categories was science specifically, and they're acknowledged for what they're doing in the field. Usually some groundbreaking stuff. So it's pretty easy to qualify as groundbreaking when you're working for NASA or working with NASA or DOD and things like that. So Forbes, it was great to be on that list.
So you had a head start by working for NASA.
Yeah, I'd say so. I'd say so. It's you know, we're all about doing the cutting edge. Like, yeah, some missions are repeat, but they're always better, right? And it's always challenging when new technology is out there.
But you have to be recognized.
Yeah, definitely, definitely.
Yeah. What are the projects you've been working on?
So,
No. How did it start?
You want to rewind and start at the beginning? So I started my first mission when I was 15. And that started as a result of me working at a summer camp, meeting the right people. I applied. I ended up getting this great internship where I had the opportunity to work in a radiation effects lab. So basically, how do our components react when they're under these space-like radiations? And at our facility, specifically at NASA Goddard in Greenbelt, we have a facility that almost simulates, it does simulate space radiation. And it's this huge chamber with like this huge door. It looks like something out of a Marvel film, like the Hulk, for example. It looks something like that, like the chamber he got trapped in. And so we put our components in there and we test them out. And that was my first internship. So a program called MMS, the multi-scale magnetospheric mission. From there, I did six other projects, one being the Perseverance Mars rover, and the latest one being the Artemis program, which is the follow-up to the Apollo program that put the first man on the moon. So the Artemis program will put the first woman and the next man on the lunar surface.
That's an amazing story.
Yeah. Yeah.
And may I ask, you are how old? You must be under 30.
Yeah, I'm 29. I'm 29.
That's an amazing career.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I'm excited to have I'm fortunate to have such an amazing career, and to keep it going. You know, it's challenging working in the space field because, again, that cutting edge technology can oftentimes be intimidating, because some individuals, such as myself, when I started out, I had a fear of failing. So when it comes to doing these things like that, you just have to kind of get into your mind that I'll probably do this and it'll probably be wrong the first few times, right? But, you know, you eventually keep getting at it. You have a great team behind you, and eventually things work out. I mean, to not oversimplify it, we're taking materials from Earth, putting it together, putting some fire behind it, and launching it into orbit. Oversimplifying it, right? But on a very base level, that's what's happening. And you know, it's all about your passion for the field. It's all about the team you have behind you, and the amazing missions that we're hoping to accomplish.
But probably getting this wrong the first couple of times, to me, it doesn't sound like an environment where you do too many experiments.
So one of my mentors told me to fail early and fail fast. And that's almost that's a mantra that I've kept with me. One of my first experiences in failure was my mentor, you know, said, "Hey, we have to design a rotor of some sort. We had to design a rotor," and he let me do it. He let me go through the design phase for it. He let me go and do the schematics for it. I picked up the material, and when I got to the material part, he actually said, "Okay, so what do you want to make this rotor out of?" And he has these sample blocks of material. They're about, you know, yay big on his desk. And one's wood, one's like an aluminum alloy, one's a titanium, one's some other material, I can't remember. But, oh, it's like a polyurethane, so it's like a plastic. And so he's like, which one do you want to make it out of? And me, being new to NASA, being new to aerospace, I choose the metal one because it's solid. It's gonna be robust against space debris. And at this point, I'm thinking like
it's
comets.
It's the obvious choice.
Yeah, yes. Obvious choice. Yeah. I'm thinking comets and meteorites at this point are going to take my satellite out if it's not as robust as possible. And he lets me go through the entire design phase. Like, I'm talking to the point where we're about to order this thing. And he comes back to me and says, hey, you know that's too heavy, right? You know that's too heavy to fly. And
so he knew that all the time.
He knew the whole time, but he allowed me to go through, like think through the full process and get to the end and actually, quote unquote, fail. It was an easy failure because you just swap out materials. Mm-hmm. But it's the concept that he allowed me to study things for myself. He allowed me to make these mistakes and thus build that confidence that it's okay to mess up. It's okay that you... you know, you didn't think of everything at first, but this is why you have a team around you to kind of catch your mistakes and learn from them. But that was my first, that wasn't my first failure in the industry, but it's one of my favorite stories to share.
But is that how you feel in the situation? Like, I failed in a constructive way?
Not at all.
No, not at all. No,
not at all.
The opposite.
It's the opposite. But,
yes.
But, you know, looking back on it now, it's something that I talk to him about often, and I replicate with my mentees.
Yes.
Not that exact same situation, obviously, but as we're going through these projects, I allow them to think through a number of different scenarios. And if I see they are headed down the wrong direction, I will, as a mentor, try to correct them, but at the same time, allow them to figure out the answer on their own.
Mm-hmm.
And as long as it doesn't impede the mission, as long as it doesn't cause delay or additional cost to the project, it's all right. And that, again, allows them to fail, quote unquote, have that, you know, have that feeling that, oh, I didn't accomplish it the first time, because you need that feeling as an engineer. You need to understand that it doesn't go right every time.
Yes.
Even if you're someone like Elon Musk, who did not get it right at the beginning at all, right? But when you step into the public light, it just seems like the Tesla or a Tesla is perfect, but we don't go through everything that was wrong with it at the beginning. So you have to have that feeling so that you can continue as an engineer, in my opinion.
It sounds like a very healthy structure.
Yeah.
And I must say, it doesn't really go with the picture I had of NASA.
Yeah, yeah. It's
that's how it is. That's really how it is.
Yeah, that's really how it is. There's almost nothing that goes right the first time at NASA or in the aerospace industry in general. Or I don't know any industry where it goes right 100% the first time. Maybe a professional chef that's been cooking for a long time. Maybe they just have the recipe down 100%. Maybe that's one of the only times I can think of something going right the first time.
Well, again, in that situation, there is no single truth. So it's easier to say that it went well.
Yeah, the margins are a lot smaller than baking a cake than launching something into space, huh?
Yeah.
Maybe I should have that comparison.
Have you ever launched anything out into space, something that went wrong too late?
There's no wood around me, but that's metal. But no, I have not. None of my projects have had catastrophic failures of that sort. You obviously have anomalies when you're dealing with launches. So you can get it into space, and there's been certain situations, not my missions, where satellites don't reach their intended orbit. So because they don't reach their intended orbit, it either takes longer or you have to use additional fuel that you didn't think you'd have to use to put it into that orbit. There's been catastrophic failures where either like a satellite will blow up before it leaves the atmosphere, or one of the most famous blunders is Hubble and its lens. So the situation with the lens was upside down, backwards, whatever it was. And so, no, luckily for me, I have not experienced that. But I think I'd be prepared. I don't think anyone's prepared for that, to be honest.
No. So on the other end of the spectrum, is there one single project that just stands out as the project?
Yeah, yeah, for me, that is the James Webb Space Telescope. It's been delayed so many times, but it's intended.
With success.
Yeah, we're aiming for success. I don't want to say it's intended launch date because we're being recorded, but its intended launch date is 2021, pending no further delays, so maybe 2022. hopefully we're not watching this in 2025, still waiting for it to go up, right? So I'm really excited for it. It really seems like it's at the point now where it'll be launched, because it was sent down to its launch facility. It was completely stowed and packed into its launch vehicle. So it's ready to go. It's what's today? Yeah, it's about a month or so out now. So I'm really excited about that. And sorry, I didn't even explain what that is. So James Webb Space Telescope is the follow-up to the Hubble Space Telescope. And the idea behind the mission, I have to like sit forward for this. The idea behind the mission is to look at first light in the galaxy, right? Like, who thinks about that? So we're trying to look back at light to the Big Bang, essentially. And it's part of its observation is because of this phenomenon in the cosmos that we know as cosmological redshift, which is basically how wavelengths become redder and redder the further from the source in the universe that it extends. And that supports the concept that the universe is constantly expanding. That supports the concept that as of now, we have not even seen a fraction of the amount of stars in the universe. Like when you look at Hubble's, deep space field, it's just a picture from Hubble. It's got, you know, hundreds of billions of stars or hundreds of thousands of stars in that little itty bitty picture. But the fun fact about that is that Hubble shoots in a very low infrared, whereas you need a very sensitive infrared camera to actually see everything that's out there. So a lot of the stars are hidden as ultraviolet light, which Hubble cannot see, which no one can see per se. So I'm excited about James Webb.
But what is the purpose? Is the purpose to confirm a theory that we have, or is it to expand?
It's to expand. So James Webb is not the first telescope or first observatory to have this kind of instrumentation on it. So it's done infrared before, or other instruments have done infrared before. But this one has much more advanced technologies. Again, comparing it to Hubble, it's about 16 times more powerful than Hubble. In addition, it'll be launched into an L2 orbit, which is 1.5 million kilometers away from Earth, in a Lagrange 2 orbit that doesn't have the interference from either the Earth or the Moon or the Sun, like the lights from any of those. So because of that, it allows the satellite to be in a much more appropriate environment to see things that we haven't seen before. So it is an expansion, but we put it into a different environment, and we've jacked up the power of these instruments, and it's really an impressive piece of hardware.
So you're writing history.
Trying to. So it was definitely a pleasure to have the opportunity to kind of work on the satellite and be kind of in that bunny suit environment and actually say that, hey, I worked on this part of the satellite and now it's in space forever. Like it's an amazing feeling.
You have a presentation here at our conference in 1.5 hours. Mm-hmm. What can the audience expect?
The audience can expect to go on a 14-year journey through my projects at NASA. I'm gonna talk about three main projects that are really near and dear to my heart for several reasons. I'm gonna give some behind the scenes kind of conversations that you wouldn't know just from reading a paper about these amazing satellites. I'm going to discuss things like climate change, how the universe is constantly expanding, and ultimately how all this can impact society. And I'm gonna do all that in about 40 minutes. So I'm gonna crunch it down. It's about 40 minutes. And hopefully they'll walk away, you know, learning some stuff about how we get from point A to point B, where, you know, how do you think about, I've got a question about the universe. How do scientists come to engineers and say, hey, I want to, like someone just comes to your office one day and says, hey, it'd be really interesting to study the Big Bang. Okay, so where do we start? Yeah. And so that's the relationship scientists have with engineers. I have this great idea. I think you can do it utilizing these kind of instruments or these kind of materials. And the engineer will say, okay, that makes sense for this, this, and this reason. It doesn't make sense for this, this, and this reason. And through that collaboration, that's how we put those boxes together. Again, put some fire behind it and get it into space.
Thank you. Yeah. Thanks a lot for joining us.
Yeah, no problem. Thanks for having me.